see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Welcome to the It's in Queens podcast. I'm your host, Jeff Simmons, and this is the only podcast that focuses on Queens, the borough that has it all, including a mountain of snow. What a way to start the week. I hope you had your snowshoes and your sleds ready. As much as I would have preferred to stay indoors, there really is no way to do that when you've got pets who just have to go outside. One of my little ones, Stella, she goes in the bathroom, I'm set there. The other one, Bruno, hates the snow and despises his balloon booties, but they do the trick, and so I took him across the street to Travers Park in Jackson Heights for just a bit. If there was a week this season for some really warm beverages like hot chocolate or something a bit more, say, spiked, this is it, people. I realize I'm going a bit stir-crazy lately because usually when the snow falls and we stay indoors, that's just a break from when we go about our normal business. But these days, as we await the end of the pandemic, everything really seems the same each day. And yes, I am thinking that every day is like Groundhog Day. By the way, happy Groundhog Day this week. I was recently thinking about how much I miss going to the theater. Not the movie theaters as much, but Broadway or off-Broadway, seeing a performance at Queens Theater. I was sifting through some old playbills and I just got, you know, somewhat depressed. There's that moment when the curtain draws or the lights go up and you know you're about to witness a spectacle, something that'll move you, bring you to tears, or make you laugh. Now, in this new world, we're experiencing much of this virtually, so it's really not the same. Over the last few years, I've had a chance to see more theatrical productions here at home in Queens and, yes, also on Broadway. I was over the moon when I went to see To Kill a Mockingbird at Queens Theater just when the sequel to the book came out. And I began around that time working with the award-winning National Yiddish Theater Volksbühne, which is the longest continuously producing Yiddish theater company in the world. One of the shows you may have heard of that launched in the summer of 2018 was called Fiddler in the Roof in Yiddish. It was a runaway success, and it was first presented at the Museum of Jewish Heritage down in Battery Park and then moved up to Stage 42 in Manhattan before it closed in early 2020. The cast was exceptional. And one thing I discovered while promoting the show was that a number of them, you guessed it, live here in Queens. There was a great photo of them on the cover of the Queens Courier at one time. One of the stars of the show was Adam B. Shapiro of Astoria. And don't confuse him with the other Adam Shapiro. There's no B there. That other Adam was on stage at the time in Waitress. Our Adam B. Shapiro of Astoria played Der Rov throughout the run of Fiddler on the Roof in Yiddish. And he received raves for his performance. He was even featured in the Queens Daily Eagle recently. And he's been keeping very busy amid the pandemic. So I recently talked with Adam about his experience on the stage, on the screen, and in his living room. Adam, welcome to the It's in Queens podcast.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
So to me, you were one of the breakout stars of Fiddler on the Roof in Yiddish. That's how I came to know you. How did you get involved with the National Yiddish Theater Volksbühne?
Oh, first of all, that's very kind. Thank you. I first auditioned for the National Yiddish Theater Volksbühne back in 2008. My career was going absolutely nowhere in the moment, and most companies wouldn't even give me a sideways glance. And I happened to notice that they were doing an audition for a show called The Kasuba, or The Marriage Contract, and there was a role in the description that I thought I could play. Now, of course, the tricky part was that the audition was in Yiddish, and up to that point, I spoke absolutely no Yiddish, save for the occasional oi. But I truly, my thought process was, well, I'm Jewish, so it's gotta be in there somewhere. And I got the materials and I worked on them and I went in and I read the scene. And I didn't end up getting cast in that first play, but I also did a pretty good audition, considering it was a language I was completely unfamiliar with. And shortly after that, they called me and they said, we're doing another show, a new musical of Isaac Bashevis Singer's Gimple the Fool, or Gimple Tom in Yiddish, and we want to see you. And they called me back in for the lead, for the role of Gimple. And I was very transparent with them about my lack of Yiddish. And they just said, we know, we can teach you. And I got the part. And by December of that year, I was doing 7 shows a week, completely in Yiddish as the lead role. And thus it began.
So as far as Fiddler on the Roof in Yiddish, that show really took off. Did you expect that?
Not for a moment. I truly did not. I was thrilled that they were doing it. I, from the moment they announced it, I said, oh, I must be a part of this. I will play whoever you want. And I was excited, of course, to work with Joel Grey and with Jackie Hoffman. And, you know, it was gonna be this really fun summer show down at the Museum of Jewish Heritage, which is a beautiful area, and right, you know, across from the Statue of Liberty and Ellis Island, which is so appropriate for Fiddler. And I never dreamed that a show in Yiddish, even Fiddler on the Roof, would reach people on such a cellular level almost, and that the demand would be so huge that we would become what we became.
So growing up, did your family speak any Yiddish?
No, I was not exposed to Yiddish at all. I was brought up in Indianapolis, which has a sizable Jewish community. People don't always realize that, but there's a sizable Jewish population in Indianapolis. But by the time I was born, Yiddish was not such a presence anymore. We all went to Hebrew school and learned Hebrew in preparation for our bar and bat mitzvahs, but Yiddish wasn't particularly on the table, at least that I heard.
Growing up, what was your first acting gig?
I'm tripping over the word gig because my first act, well, my first, you know, time on stage was a kindergarten talent show doing a scene from Snow White and the Seven Dwarves by myself. My first time in a musical, I was 9, and it was Fiddler on the Roof at the JCC theater camp. And I was Muttle the Tailor. I was, you know, probably 4 inches shorter than the guy who played Tevye and still a first soprano. And it was, you know, then I did theater all through high school. My first professional gig was in 2002 at the Barn Theater in Augusta, Michigan, doing their summer stock season.
So for those who did not get a chance to see Fiddler on the Roof in Yiddish, they may still recognize you from the small screen, from The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel, and of course, correct my pronunciation if I've done it wrong. Talk about that role.
Well, yes, it's Maisel.
I will get it right.
Not a problem. But that was really fun. I was brought in for Maisel for the first time in August of 2017. And of course, this was before anyone had really heard of it. You know, the season one was still filming and I knew very little about it, but I knew that Tony Shalhoub was involved and I love him. And I read the synopsis, you know, the general synopsis, and I was fascinated by the idea of a woman in the 1950s pursuing a career in stand-up comedy. I was like, this is something I really haven't seen on TV before. So I was very interested. I was called in for the role of their cantor. And I said, oh, I can sing in Hebrew. I know how to do that. I've been doing that most of my life. So I was delighted to be brought in as the Maisel's cantor, and then brought in for season two on one of my days off from Fiddler, where I was playing a rabbi. So I don't know if God was trying to tell me something, that I had missed my calling somehow, but at least I can say I play a rabbi on stage and a cantor on TV.
So why I was so excited to have you here on the It's in Queens podcast is because you are an Astoria resident, and this podcast, this podcast celebrates Queens. What brought you to Queens, and what are some of your favorite places?
Well, I have lived in Astoria actually for, I have to do math really quick, about 16 and a half years. I moved here right out of college, right when I moved from Indiana. And I had some friends who had graduated before me who were living in the area. And, I was moving out here alone, and I would like to be near some people I know. So I asked a couple of them for recommendations for brokers in the neighborhood. And I came out here and went right from the airport to Metropolis Realty on 23rd Avenue. And, they just started showing me the neighborhood, and I'm just walking around, it felt like such a warm and fun place. You know, I'm seeing all of these restaurants and all of these, particularly Greek owned businesses, and it all just looked like such a lovely sojourn from so much of what I knew in Manhattan from visiting. So I loved the idea of being able to, at the end of a long day of, whether I was working a temp job or in a show or whatever, being able to come back to a neighborhood. And, originally when I first moved here, I thought, okay, I'll live here a few years and then maybe I'll move into Manhattan. And then a few years went by and I said, I'm not moving to Manhattan. Why would I? Everything I need is right here.
That's what we like to say. Queens has it all. Amid the pandemic, so many people have, I'll admit, some have struggled to seamlessly move over to virtual, but you, it seems like this was seamless with you, and you've done presentations, productions from your living room in Queens. You most recently had a holiday special in December. Talk a little about that.
Well, about 5.5-6 years ago, I decided I wanted to kind of get into video production a little bit. I saw people like Padraic Hall and Randy Rainbow who were really making a name for themselves on YouTube. And, I kind of saw that. And it was kind of like when I auditioned for the Volksbühne, where I was like, hey, I don't know how to do that, but I feel like it's in there somewhere if I can just find it. So I started learning about green screen production, and I started making my own videos out of my living room. And I had a series called One Man Broadway, where I would recreate Broadway production numbers where I played all the parts. And when I say one man Broadway, it was one man, it was me. It was, doing the sound mixing and making the costumes and styling the wigs, of which I now have many. And, and then doing all of the editing. It was all this one man. And so when the pandemic hit and, everybody was sort of like, well, what do we do now? I started seeing people doing these living room concerts, and I did one for the Volksbühne actually, because they've been doing Volksbühne live since last March. And then at a certain point, I was noticing certain technical difficulties that people were running into a lot doing these living room concerts. And I just remember thinking, oh, it would be so great to do a pre-recorded thing and be able to mitigate those issues, you know, take them out of the equation. So then I just sort of thought, well, I know how to do that. I've been doing these videos for 5 years. What if we took it to the next level? And I'm very lucky to have a roommate named Janice Hall, who is an accomplished performer in her own right, particularly in the world of opera, but also in the world of cabaret and theater. And we've performed together many times, and we call our apartment Shapiro Hall.
I love that.
It named itself. And so I knocked on her door one day and I said, I have a proposal for you. Would you like to do essentially a TV special with me where we'll create everything, we'll film it in the living room, I'll edit it, and then we'll sort of broadcast it almost as if we're doing a Facebook Live or something that won't completely be live. We can do it in the style of like the old variety shows like Carol Burnett, Sonny and Cher, and just show people something different. And she agreed, and we started coming up with ideas, and about 6 weeks later, we premiered our first show under the title of Stilla Live from Shapiro Hall. And we broadcasted, and people, I don't think, were initially prepared for what we were gonna do. They thought they were just gonna see another living room concert. And then all of a sudden our living room wall flies out and our chairs move on their own accord. And they realize, oh no, this is not just your typical living room concert. Initially we thought we were just doing the one, but we ended up doing four. We ended up doing that one in the middle of summer, one for Halloween, and one for the holidays.
A great series. So I want to just pivot slightly to the pandemic. The cultural sector, as you know, it's just been hit incredibly hard over this past year. Stages are still closed across the city. When you talk with friends and colleagues, what are you hearing about how they're doing and what has helped you through this period?
Well, people are doing different things. People are pivoting within the industry and getting into voiceover work, or they're pivoting out of the industry. I have, I think, two people who have gotten into real estate. So it's very individual because, you know, the question I really hate is there any idea when things are going to reopen? No, of course there's not. Nobody knows. Stop asking. because nobody has any control over this. And, you know, we're hoping that the vaccine rollout becomes more organized now, and that we can, you know, quickly get as many people vaccinated as possible so that we can start to reopen. But what has helped me is, doing these specials has been a big help for me. Having things to focus on has been the big thing that has helped me, whether it's one of our specials or I've been working on my debut EP, or working on something. I also produced a Hanukkah special for the Volksbühne, which took quite a bit of attention. And then meanwhile, I've been able to go back and pick up certain television shows that I've been meaning to watch. And it's just, it's a weird time. It's a very strange time. As my therapist and I kind of said way, way, way back when all this was starting, we don't have to be perfect. We're all just doing the best we can.
It's a good sentiment.
So, everybody's doing their best, and someone's best may be very active and productive, and someone else's best may be, relaxing and trying to stay as zen as they can and not feeling the need to produce and create, and both are completely valid.
So you mentioned a few moments ago that you've been working on your debut EP. Can you talk a little about that and what else is on the horizon for you?
Okay. I don't know how much I can say about the EP yet, but I've been working with a wonderful group called Recording Artist Development, or RAD, because they're very rad. And they're wonderful. They work with they work with singers and singer-songwriters who are looking really to get into recording, and helping them for me personally, they really help me to find my voice as a recording artist as opposed to just a performer, because it's a very different art form. And you can do something on a stage and be as big as you want to, but when the microphone's 2 inches from your face, it's a very different and much more intimate world. Phil Carroll, who's the producer of RAD, he helped me to really learn what that means and build these tracks. So I have 6 tracks recorded, all by, New York songwriters who I have worked, well, most of them I've worked with. All songs that have either never been recorded or only been recorded by the songwriter. I released one of them last year as a single called Warm as Winter by Nicholas Levin. And that dropped during Fiddler on the Roof, which was really, really fun. I sort of found out that it had officially dropped in the dressing room. And then the next night I walked in and someone started playing Warm as Winter on their Bluetooth speaker. And I was like, that's weird to suddenly hear your own voice. I'm hoping to release the full EP in late spring of this year. Originally it was supposed to be fall of last year, and then that didn't happen. But I'm really hoping to release it sometime in 2021.
So if our listeners want to know more about you, where should they go?
They can go to my website, adambshapiro.com. Don't forget, if there's no B, then it's not me. So adambshapiro.com. I'm also on Twitter and Instagram as the Adam B. Shapiro. There's only one. I'm trying to be more active on Insta and Twitter. I'm not the world's best social media person, but I'm trying really hard because I want to stay connected with people. What's next? That is the eternal question, isn't it? The God's honest truth is right now, I don't know. I'm working on a few things that I'm not quite ready to talk about yet. Again, I hope that the EP will drop sometime in the first half of this year. I would imagine Shapiro Hall will be doing another special probably in the spring. We needed a little rest after the holidays because between our Halloween special, the folks being a Hanukkah special, and our holiday special, I was basically filming and editing every day for 3.5 months solid. So once that new year hit, he needed a break.
Well, with that, Adam B. Shapiro, I want to thank you for appearing here on the It's in Queens podcast.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me.
I could gvell over Adam's performance. He's a true mensch. And that, other than Nosh and Meshuggah, really is the extent of my Yiddish. One thing you'll be cavilling about this season, the 2021 calendar by the Queens Economic Development Corporation. That features a beautiful photo of a local cultural institution for each month and a bonus image on the back. And each month has special information on the highlighted institution along with contact information. It's beautiful. It's educational. It's a keepsake and a great housewarming gift. Who's inside? The Museum of the Moving Image, Sculpture Center, Flushing Town Hall, Queens Botanical Garden, MoMA PS1, New York Hall of Science, Socrates Sculpture Park, Queens County Farm Museum, Queens Zoo, Jamaica Center for Arts and Learning, Jamaica Performing Arts Center, the Harriet and Kenneth Kupferberg Holocaust Center, Alley Pond Environmental Center, and Queens Museum. And there's also a page dedicated to the Queens Economic Development Corporation programs. Oh, did I mention? It's free. Well, it can be free, though you might incur a postage fee. So contact Rob McKay at rmackay@queensny.org or call 718-263-0546 and discuss how you can get the calendar. By the way, you can also send a stamped self-addressed envelope to Rob at this address. It's QEDC's main office at 120-55 Queens Boulevard, Kew Gardens, New York, 11424. That's how you can get a copy. And remember, this offer lasts only until the supply runs out. You know one thing that'll never run out? Rob's advice on where to go in Queens. So now, let's bring you his week's report.
Hello, Jefe. Well, we are in February right now, of course, and that's a very short month, but it includes some very big events, such as Black History Month, Valentine's Day, the Super Bowl, Lunar New Year this year, and then, of course, there's the little snowstorm that just passed through Queens. Anyway, we've got some interesting stuff coming up. I'll do a little bit of all of those subjects, but first, I want to talk about a new movie called A Glitch in the Matrix, which the Museum of Moving Image is going to stream from February 2nd to February 21st. You go online, you download it, all that kind of stuff. It's a brand new documentary that looks at whether or not we humans are living in a video game simulation controlled by some unknowable entity. You know, that question that people have been asking recently. So this actually, the movie actually has interviews with, I guess you would call them simulation theorists, maybe, or simulation believers, and first-hand accounts of some occurrences which people think explain this phenomenon. It's one of those things. I'm actually going to watch it with my daughters because it's kind of freaky. It is something that I've heard a lot of people talking about over the past couple of years since the internet blew up. Flushing Town Hall is going to do a Black History Month celebration in three parts. It involves Broadway performers, very talented Broadway performers, showing their music and entertainment skills, and also reading speeches from influential African Americans. The first night, the first episode, is February 5th at 7 o'clock. An actor by the name of Alton Fitzgerald White, who is probably most famous for The Lion King, but he was also in Ragtime. He'll do a thing about John Lewis, the civil rights leader and Georgia congressman, talking about how this guy's the congressman's speeches and struggles and everything else about his life. In the same vein, the Queen's Public Library has joined forces with the Black Caucus of the American Library Association, and the two entities are going to hold a 24-hour virtual event or a health summit specifically designed to the health issues in African American communities. That means that they're experts in the fields of medicine and science, plus a slew of entertainers, musicians, and athletes that are going to talk about, well, basically, three main sort of categories or subgroups: health education, health connections for the mind, body, and soul, and health through transformative practices. Staying along that line, the Louis Armstrong House Museum and the Forum for Cultural Engagement through the U.S. Embassy of Moscow are going to stream a concert that reprises the original Real Ambassadors album that's actually 60 years old. It involves Louis Armstrong, Satchmo, and one of his great performances. And this actual show features a jazz musical that Dave and Iola Brubeck, the jazz greats, wrote in Satchmo's honor. That will stream on February 9th at 1 p.m. through Louis Armstrong House Museum. Lunar New Year. Queens Botanical Garden will be celebrating Lunar New Year straight from February 6th to February 28th. Stop by anytime. The garden is dressed up in festive decor. They're giving away free craft activity kits, and they're going to have a plant sale. It's the year of the ox, and so you'll see a lot of themes. And some of the main plants that they will be selling are jades and peace lilies. And that is straight through until February 28th. And then we'll probably have more on Valentine's Day next week, because I know that Jeff, amongst other people, is a romantic devil. Anyway, February 7th, the King Manor Museum, the Director of Education Brittany Lester will actually explain the history of Valentine's Day, how it went from a pagan holiday to the most popular day for people to ask for engagements or to people to get engaged. There's an interesting twist that involves the Industrial Revolution. So tune into that on February 7th at 2 p.m. It's funny, but it's also interesting. All right, Jeff, that's it for now. I'll talk to you soon. Thanks, guys. Bye.
So if the snow hasn't melted by now and you're stuck indoors, you'll always be able to find something else to do when you visit the Queen's Tourism Council's It's in Queens website. There's so much happening online these days. If you want to learn more about what's going on in Queens, or virtually, but really produced and presented from Queens, then don't stop with this podcast. Bookmark the It's in Queens website, itsinqueens.com, on your desktop. It'll be easy to plan ahead that way. And you could also make it much easier and get notified right in your inbox. And the way to do that is to sign up for the Queens Economic Development Corporation's newsletter at queensny.org, queensny.org. And remember, I say this every week, when you're in Queens or you just are thinking about Queens, tag us, hashtag us, It's in Queens. Follow us at It's in Queens on Twitter. I'm your host, Jeff Simmons. Enjoy this winter wonderland and see you next week on the It's in Queens podcast.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.